welcome you all to this bicentennial series of lectures. As we know, the Deccan College Postgraduate and Research Institute, the third oldest educational institute in the country, is celebrating its bicentennial this year. To mark this occasion, the university has proposed to organize special lectures to be delivered by eminent scholars in the field of archaeology, linguistics, and Sanskrit. Today's guest of honor, today's lecture will be delivered by Professor Divakar Acharya. I would request our Vice Chancellor, Professor Prasad Joshi, to welcome our guest of honor.
Thank you, Professor Shailendra Mohan. Namaskar and good afternoon to all of you. I am once again very pleased today to extend our special welcome to Dr. Divakarji Acharya, who is going to deliver today a lecture in this very important series of bicentenary lectures. Actually, when we started with this idea, every month we should listen to one important topic in the fields of, in the three disciplines that Deccan College is devoted to. And this is the fifth lecture in the series. So, while welcoming the guest of honor today, Dr. Divakarji Acharya, I am really feeling very happy and very proud. Actually, why we started this series? The idea is that this is going to give us an opportunity to listen to the eminent scholars in the field. And okay, it is really fitting tribute to the institute which is devoted to these disciplines for last two centuries. So this is the occasion we are marking with various academic activities, and organizing of this lecture series, webinar series, is one of those activities. So Dr. Divakarji Acharya is going to add one more flower to this garland in the form of webinars. So once again, I welcome you, Dr. Divakarji. This is my duty to appreciate the efforts taken by the webinar committee in continuously organizing this lecture without drop. And this is the fifth lecture in the series. So I appreciate the efforts taken by Professor Shailendra Mohan and his team in getting over all the hurdles while organizing and making us feel privileged and happy that we are listening to eminent scholars every month. Once again, I welcome our guest of honor today. Sir, we celebrate your presence here and feel highly privileged to listen to you. With these few words, I would like to stop here. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Silpa Suman to introduce our today's guest of honor, Professor Divakar Acharya.
Namaskar. A very good afternoon to all of you, and Professor Divakar Acharya, very good morning to you. Today I have a privilege to introduce the speaker of today's bicentenary lecture, Professor Divakar Acharya. Professor Acharya is Spalding Professor of Eastern Religions and Ethics at the University of Oxford since 2015. This position is one of the preeminent positions in the world in the study of Asian religions and was established in 1936. It was held by Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, the former president of India, until 1952. The other distinguished scholars of this position were Professor Sener, B.K. Matilal, and Alexis Sanderson. And now Professor Acharya is continuing that grand legacy in the studies of Eastern religions and philosophy at Oxford. Before his appointment in Oxford, Professor Acharya was associated with the graduate school at Kyoto University as a visiting professor from 2006. In 2011, he was appointed as Associate Professor of Indological Studies in Kyoto University. Before that, he was Research Associate in Hamburg University from 2003 to 2006. From 1993 to 2003, he worked as assistant professor in Nepal Sanskrit University. Professor Acharya was born in a small village near Kathmandu and completed his school and college education in Kathmandu, selecting the combination of traditional and modern subjects related to Sanskrit grammar, literature and logic. Later, for his post-graduation, he came to Sampurnananda Sanskrit Vidyalaya, Banaras, to study Shaivism. He did his PhD in Hamburg and worked for the Nepal German Manuscript Preservation and Cataloging Project for a couple of years. Discovering, editing, and publishing of new texts from the manuscript material is his prime interest of research. Tracing the evolution of Indian religions and philosophical ideas, and early history of South Asia, Nepal in particular, are his main research interests. Professor Acharya is a member of advisory committee of Collection Indology, published by the French Institute of Pondicherry from 2008. He is editor-in-chief of the Journal of Indian Philosophy from 2014. He was also involved in the Clay Sanskrit Library and translated Shudraka's Vruchakatika. He has collaborated in the editing project of the Skanda Purana. Some of his important publications related to Tantric studies are Early Tantric Vaishnavism, a critical edition with an introduction and notes from palm leaf manuscripts of the three newly discovered works of the Pancharatra, the Svayambhu Pancharatra, Devamrita Pancharatra and Ashtadasha Vidhana. For Prill's Encyclopedia of Hinduism, he has written an article on the Pashupatas. Some of his notable articles are an investigation into the background of the Shaiva Siddhanta concept of innate impurity, that is Mala, how to behave like a bull, new insight into the origin and religious practices of Pashupatas, three fragmentary folios of a 9th century manuscript of an early Bhuta Tantra taught by Mahameshwara, the role of Chanda in the early history of the Pashupata cult, and the image of on the Mathura pillar dated Gupta year 61. As an example of his writing on the early history of Nepal, I may quote his article, The Issue of Remarriage, Adultery and Child Production in Ancient Nepal, An Insight into the Manigao Inscription of Vishnugupta, dated in Lichhavi Samvat 57. He has written extensively on the issues concerning Indian philosophy, one of his favorite subjects on which he has chosen to speak today. Some select publications in this field are This World in the Beginning was Phenomenally Non-Existent, Aruni's Discourse on Cosmogony in the Chandogya Upanishad, then The Upanishadic Method of Neti Neti and the Jaina Doctrine of Anekanta, Neti Neti, Meaning and Function of an Enigmatic Phrase in the Gargya Ajatashatru dialogue of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, On the Meaning and Function of Adesha in the Early Upanishads, and also Vachaspati Mishra Tattva Samiksha, the earliest commentary on Mandana Mishra's Brahma Siddhi. All of you will witness his scholarship through his talk today. With this short introduction, I warmly welcome our today's speaker, Professor Divakar Acharya, and request him to present his talk on the notion of Purusha and Atman in the Vedic text and their merger in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Dhanyavadah. I sincerely thank my chancellor sir, Prasad Joshi ji, Professor Shailendra ji, and Shilpa ji for very kind and warm welcome and kind words. Without losing any time further, let me enter and start to talk on that topic. Samsrutena Gamemahi. So from the title and the abstract, you probably have got this idea that these days when we understand Atman in a particular sense, particularly from Advaita Vedanta perspective, it is eternal essence that is individualized as personal self when it is embodied, but in the cosmic realm, it is Brahman, the supreme self, permeated all and everything. But this characterization and its elevation to the ultimate principle is the culmination of Vedic reflection on the notion of the self. And as I understand, this sophistication in the notion of Atman happened only after the merger of the notion of Atman with that of Purusha, the universal person, the primordial person, who situates himself in each and everything and appears as very calm individual entity. In the Rig Veda, altogether, 26 times the term Atman occurs, 21 times independently, 3 times as the first member of the compound, and twice as the last member of the compound. Among these, in one place, the wind is described as the Atman of Varuna, when in two places, Atman is simply correlated with the wind by juxtaposing the two as if one qualifies the other. And more, a stanza from the 10th book addresses a deceased person and says that his eyes should go to the sun and Atman to the wind. Another stanza praises the wind as the Atman of God and the embryo of the world. On the basis of these 5 attestations, some scholars deduce that Atman is the life breath whose correlative in the cosmic sphere is the wind, described as the breath of God. This seems fitting in many cases. Therefore, some scholars even now relate Atman to German Atem. Against Reinhold's decades-old warning that this correlation of Atman and Vata, wind, is very secondary. Actually, as we check other occurrences of the term, we find that not just the wind, but more elements or elemental divinities are described in the Rig Veda as Atman. At one place, the sun is said to fill earth, heaven and atmosphere and thus become Atman of all beings. And in another place, Atman of all beings is seen as deposited in the bull-like rain, inseminating female-like crops and herbs. Beyond these cosmic elements, at 5 places, the food or the juice of Soma is identified as Atman. Therefore, we should think critically what is here equally present in the wind, sun, rain, the juice of Soma, food, which helps the poet to see all these entities as Atman of this or that in this or the other world. As far as I can see, it is vital force in the body that is seen as the substance or embodiment of life. This meaning fits it in all 12 cases I just mentioned, though in one of the cases of its equation with food, it can also be interpreted as the inner vital body covered by the cloth of physical body outside. So there is contrast between Atman and Tanu. And particularly in the oldest part of Rig Veda, in the 9th book, the occurrences of Atman, as Jemison translates, it should be translated as embodiment. So, as the substance of life, Atman permeates all vital functions, senses, psychological entities, the entire body and the self. The early Vedic poets apparently thought of this substance as coming from different natural elements or cosmic forces, and therefore those elements and forces they figuratively described as Atman. Evidence shows that they regarded the life substance as spread all over the body of a living being, and as forming a vital body that participated in all vital functions. Therefore, they use the same term Atman to refer to this inner body. Likewise, Atman means the vital body at three places, and in one of them, it is even contrasted with the physical body. In one place, the term can be interpreted as either the body or the reflexive self. Two healing stanzas addressed to a sick person speak of winning back his Atman, which can be interpreted either his life, like substance, or vital body, that is, thought to have escaped during sickness. Likewise, Atman is used in one another place in the sense of the entirety, the body, of a wasting disease. One occurrence in the healing context, Atman clearly means the physical body with its all internal organs and external parts from which a healer roots out the disease. In another place, Atman means the internal subtle body that goes to heaven. The poet sees it flying in the sky. Apparently, the Vedic poets thought that the vital body heals up the entire physical body, and if the physical body incurred a permanent damage, there is a chance that the vital body too is damaged. As the vital body consists in mind, speech, breath, and senses, and thus represents the totality of human consciousness, it is no surprise that Atman, together with its cognate Taman without R, serves as a reflexive self expressing this totality or the vital body or simply the body. In two places where Atman appears as the last member in the compound, Satatman, the term can somehow convey reflexivity, because Satatman can mean an entity itself assuming hundreds of forms, or else the one who has 100 bodies or being, the way Jameson and Bredesen translate, they say embodiment, body, taking Atman in the generalized sense of body. In the Atharva Veda, the term occurs more than 60 times, and here it is most frequently used as a reflexive pronoun that was rare in the Rig Veda. Whitney and Landman have translated the term mostly as reflexive pronoun, sometimes as soul or self, and rarely as life and body. But after reading these stanzas in their actual context, I have found that it is possible to look at them from the perspective I just presented. In short, irrespective of ratio, we can say that Atman in the Atharva Veda has almost the same connotation as in the Rig Veda. There are, however, some significant stanzas in the Atharva Veda that shed new light on the meaning of Atman in the early Vedic time. For example, there is one important stanza providing evidence for the idea that Atman is the base or origin of physical body one may get time after time. It says, The heaven-goer has variously transformed his body as he found one of another color in his Atman. Similarly, another stanza speaks of plurality of Atman, the eye, the breath, and the other. This lends support to the idea that Atman means the entirety of vital functions. Though we are not told what are the other Atmans beyond the eye, the breath, that is given to Agni. This is from the cremation context. At least in five places, including the one just mentioned, the breath and Atman are enumerated side by side as distinguished from each other. This has surprised some scholars, but I think when one or the other vital function is mentioned separately alongside Atman, it is logical to think that Atman in that occurrence covers all other functions except the those mentioned, though in normal situation it covers all of them together. Moreover, since each of vital functions is seen as a functional expression of one and the same Atman, each of them can be figuratively named as Atman. So that way, sometimes even there is mentioning of plural Atman in case of even individual being. I should also mention here the last stanza of the second Skanda Sukta in Atharva Veda, where Vaishnava thought, as reported by Renu, an Upanishadic accent appears suddenly. It sounds so if we translate Atman as soul, as Whitney and Lineman translated, but we should not hurry up to adopt this interpretation. Or it is better to take Atmanam in that stanza as a reflexive pronoun and all evidence in the first half of the stanza as referring to Indra mentioned by name two stanzas before. In my opinion, this and the two preceding stanzas refer to the presence of Indra in the heart and body as an adorable or mysterious element, Yaksha. Such a description of individual self as Indra can also be found in the Shatapatha Brahmana, Jaiminiya Brahmana, and even Vedaranyaka Upanishad. We can also note that the adjectives Ajara and Yuvan are used together to describe Indra once more in the Rigveda. Therefore, in this line, I would translate that stanza in this way. So, free from desire, wise, immortal, self-existent, satisfied with sap, not deficient in any respect, knowing himself as none but that wise, unaging and young Indra, one is not afraid of him. So in earlier time, before, finally in Upanishad, we have this equation of Atman and Brahman, the ultimate reality. So individual self should be equated with the ultimate reality. But in early times, they used to equate individual self with the deity they worship. It can be Indra, it can be Prajapati and Brahman Prajapati, and later in Upanishad phase they have more and more abstract notion and they equate it only with Brahman. So as Dvaisan thought, there is this already sophisticated Upanishadic notion of Atman in Atharva Veda that is not tenable. So now I come to Yajurveda. The Yajurvedic and other mantras of the Middle Vedic period too provide some new clues. Apart from naming the ritual or other entities as Atman of one or the other body, here or in the other world, they stand witness for the fact that as time passes, mental and moral faculties of the human being are one after the other distinguished and enumerated alongside Atman as independent entity. This sets ground for a psychological analysis of the human self later in the Upanishad. In these texts, we also find Atman juxtaposed not only to the physical body, Tanu, but also to limbs, Anga, allowing an additional usage of Atman in a new sense of the torso, minus hands and legs and the middle torso. Like in the Yajurvedic mantra text, Atman in the Brahmanas covers a wide range of meaning, but all of them are related to the inner enduring vital body, not just life. So we are told that in pre-Upanishadic Brahmanical usage, Atman generally means body. This meaning, as Renu says, seems to burn from the exegesis of the Agnichayana ceremony. But even in that context, Atman is not just the physical body, but the inner body that survives death and reaches heaven or is reconstituted via after its all parts are delivered by the cremation fire. It is the divine inner body of vitality of the sacrificer, contrasted to his outer human body, sometimes described as the persisting body of the ritualist made of his ritual acts or the Vedic mantras. In short, Atman in Vedic Samhitas and Brahmanas can mean the substance of life, the reflexive self, the inner body, or even just the body, just body, or even the torso, but not yet the all-pervasive supreme self. At this point, I should mention that there are some other terms already found in the Rig Veda, Ashu, Manas, Ayus, Manyu, Prana and Purusha, each of which denotes some certain aspect of the core essence of human being. Scholars have tried to find out what concepts are behind these words, and by arranging them, hypothesize the unitary or dualistic theory of soul conceptions. The most prominent of these scholars is Ernst Arman, an early 20th century Indologist and ethnologist, as summarized by Bremer in 1951. In his analysis, Arman distinguished between body souls and endowing the body with life and consciousness, and the free soul, an unencumbered soul representing the individual personality. The free soul is active during unconsciousness and passive during consciousness.
when the conscious individual replaces it. It is not exactly clear where the passive free soul resides in the body. The body souls are active during the waking life of the living individual. In contrast to the free soul, the body soul is often divided into several parts. Usually, it falls into two categories. One is the life soul, frequently identified with the breath, the life principle. The other is the ego soul, the body soul. First, several of its parts represent the inner self of the individual. In this early stage of the development of Vedic soul belief, the free soul and the body souls did not constitute a unity. Later, the concept of the Vedic free soul, Atman, incorporated the psychological attributes of the body soul, a development that occurred among a number of people, I unquote. So all this was a summary of Atman. So he believed that there are two types of souls, free soul and then a body soul, which can be interpreted differently. But Arman's this theory, which was based mainly on early Vedic materials, has been adopted by many to analyze soul conceptions in ancient Greece and also other primitive cultures. But in the field of Indian studies, only a few scholars have subscribed to Arman's dualistic theory, though many have adopted his terminology without subscribing. For example, Paul Hors presents the whole phenomena in a simplified way, stating that in the oldest period, we come across the concept of a physical impersonal vital force, Asu, and the spiritual principle, Manas, added to which later was the idea of a breath soul, Prana, and finally of the Atman. So, this is without quoting, he more or less, in essence, subscribes Arman's idea. Bodewitz discusses Arman's theory and acknowledges and evidence pluralism of soul conceptions, but thinks that it is the researcher who arranges this pluralistic material and hypothesizes a unitary or dualistic concept of the soul. Therefore, with slight ambiguity, he states that generally the Sanskrit term asu and manas have been regarded as the soul concepts of the oldest period of the Veda, and that for the later period, most scholars had assumed one unitary concept, denoted as Atman or Purusha, the self or person. I find it a bit problematic, methodologically faulty, that one comes with his mind preoccupied with the concept of soul. When he faces difficulties in his efforts to interpret Atman and soul in early occurrences of the term and is forced to adjust his concept, calls Atman, these are that type of body soul. In my opinion, in the early Rig Vedic and Atharva Vedic hymns, Atman stands for the inner vital body, as I earlier presented, or the substance of life, when Asu and Manas stand for the individuating principle capable of thinking. But soon, the original function of Asu and Manas is taken over either by Purusha or Atman, and they are devoted to mean the vital breath and mind. In the 10th mandala of the Rig Veda and in most of the Atharva Veda, Purusha is the thinking person, experiencing his self as an integrated whole of the thinking principle and the inner vital body it controls. I do not think that we have any indication to prove that Vedic people in any period of time believed in dualistic or pluralistic conception of the soul or the self. Scholars do not distinguish the concept of Atman or Purusha, as in the quotations I mentioned, even Bodewitz is equating Atman and Purusha, the same way Paul Hors did that. As Prajnadas notes, it is the term Purusha which, according to Arman, refers to originally and exclusively to the free soul in ancient Indian culture. According to her, relying mainly on Upanishadic passages, Arman introduce the element of functioning inside the body and even governing it in connection with this notion of Purusha, which is identified with Atman according to her. So there is no distinction between the two. Just like Arman, his followers and opposers equally identify Purusha with Atman. They do not discuss the conditions and backgrounds from which the two notions of Purusha and Atman have emerged. nor do they analyze how and when the semantic range of these two terms merge. Let me investigate a little in this direction. Vedic philosophical speculations begin to appear mainly in the first and tenth book of the Rig Veda. The major theme of these early speculations is cosmogony, creation and the primeval source of the universe. Vedic thinkers were also enchanted by the magical power of the ritual they had imagined. Through these speculations, these thinkers soon came to support a primordial person as the source of the universe and thus his agency in its creation by way of his self-sacrifice or creative desire or completion. As their ideas were refined, they began to philosophize on this theme and came to conclude that this person, after creating everything in the world, has multiplied himself and entered every individual body, human or non-human, heavenly or worldly, has its core essence or soul, so that it comes to life and has its own individual standing. Thus emerging from this process was the powerful concept of eternal, omnipresent and omnipotent entity of Purusha, the fourth shining one, the burning one. Although the logic was naive and simple, always in the world a man is seen acting for the sake of achieving a goal. Therefore, there should always be a man-like agent behind every action in the cosmos. In this way, these speculative thinkers projected the human person and his agency to the universal level. On the other hand, the notion of Atman was not among the themes of philosophical speculation until the late Vedic period of Aranyakas and Upanishads, although it was an intrinsic component of the Vedic eschatological theory based on efficacy of the sacrifice and the ritualistic magical causation. As stated earlier, Atman originally meant to be substance of vitality that spread all over the physical body and formed the vital body inside, enlivening the whole organism of the individual. Thus, the notion of Atman was body-oriented, life-oriented, individual totality-oriented. It did not involve the idea of subtlety or core essence or immortality, immateriality. Since the self-awareness of a human being is the experience of his psychophysical complex involving this inner body, the term Atman was used as a reflexive pronoun also to express his experience. Thus, these notions of Atman and Purusha have emerged clearly from two different backgrounds. The notion of Atman was resulted from the human endeavor to understand human life and its multifaceted but coordinated experience by the individual, whereas the notion of Purusha resulted from the instinctive projection of agency, human person, to the cosmic level by way of the myth of primordial person that depicted him as the agent, material source, and also beneficiary of the perennial creation process. The Vedic culture primarily believed in reconstitution of human body in heaven after its disintegration here, or else in its journey there too. In this model, the real person appears to be an integrated whole of the inner body and the self-conscious thinking and experiencing principle, call it Asu or Manas or Purusha, which addressed in healing sessions or post-mortem rituals. After the advent of the concept of repeated death, before the idea of reincarnation, Punarjanma, we have this concept of Punarmrityu, repeated death, only the regular performers of Agnihotra or Agnichayana were allowed to stay in heaven forever. The others who did not do so had to die in heaven and return to the earth repeatedly. To be in this cycle of transmigration, however, was regarded as good, and being thrown outside into the territory of darkness, only that as bad. Introduced in the next stage was the concept of liberation through permanent disintegration of the enduring inner body. If the individual body is disintegrated permanently, the person is no more individual, but universal. To achieve this goal, as it is described in the teaching of Sandilya, found in the Satapatha Brahmana, actually that is the Sandilya's part, at the end of the 10th book, there is the older Upanishad of Bhadasaniya, and this passage I am going to talk about makes the part of that. But when Brihadaranyaka Upanishad was canonized, only two segments out of 11 from this older Upanishad of Shandilya's Bhadasaniya Brahmana, only two related to Ashwamedha were incorporated in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, others were dropped. But this idea is also found in the Chandogya Upanishad. To disintegrate this inner body and to be liberated, one was supposed to auto-suggest in his lifetime that he is the subtler than the subtlest Purusha inside the universal body that is all-present, greater than the greatest, free and capable as to hold sway of all quarters and pervade everything here. But still, at this stage, Purusha and Atman were clearly distinguished. Sandilya locates Purusha inside Atman and describes it as a grain of rice, or a grain of barley, or a grain of millet, or the smallest granule of millet. So Purusha is described as the smaller than the smallest, and then the person wanted to be free from individual body and be in the universal body that is greater than the greatest. And clearly, here he talks about antar atman Purusha. So the clear distinction of Purusha and Atman. These two concepts of Purusha and Atman are marked only in the second chapter of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, actually that is in the teaching of Yajnavalkya. Judging from the perspective of conceptual development, the second chapter of the Brihadaranyaka is too important. It stands between the older material of chapter 1, 5 and 6 and newer materials in chapter 3 and 4 of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, which comes from the world of Yajnavalkya. Its first and third sections present the method of neti-neti and analyze Brahman and Purusha. More relevant to present topic is the fifth section of the chapter known as Madhu Brahmana. It talks of the person consisting of brilliance and immortality represented in universal entity and also corresponding bodily entity, including abstract ones like human nature. It correlates the universal and bodily representations of Purusha one by one and identifies both as Atman. At every instance, it equates the self with Brahman, the immortal, the all beings here in the world. It is important to note that this text imagines multiple representations of Purusha within a single individual self, just like in the universe or within the universal self. So it starts with, it first says Purusha in the earth and Purusha in the earth element in the body. And then these both Purushas are none other than this Atman. So Yajnavalkya here is presenting new abstract idea of Atman and equating that with the cosmic person and the bodily person. So this correlation and identification scheme concludes with the same analogy of will that is found once already in the first chapter of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. But this time, the will is more advanced with extra components. Earlier, the self was seen only as the hub, and his personal belongings were seen as the ring. So Atman is the individual self earlier. So the Atman is in the center and all possessions, belongings, these make the ring, the will. But now, in this section of Madhu Brahmana, now the self is likened to the both hava and rim, and everything in existence, including the gods, worlds, are likened to the spokes in between, fitted and supported by the hava and rim, both of Atman. The text says, as all spokes are fitted together into the hub and rim of a wheel, the chariot, exactly so, fitted into this self are all beings, all gods, all worlds, all vital functions, all of these belonging to the self. Thus, in this monologue, the notion of Atman has advanced across the boundary of individuality into the abstract and broader level. After this development, Atman has precedence over Purusha. Now, Atman means the individual self as well as the universe. The Purusha is used as a synonym of Atman still, but basically only in the sense of an individual self or a partial and functional representation of the universal Atman. And even in this sense, it is not preferred. It is noteworthy that after this development in the middle portion of the Vedaranyaka Upanishad, the doctrine of Purusha is put forward by Yajivarkya's rival. For example, Vidagdha Sakalya in the third chapter talks about Purusha as individual representation, but in the conclusion of the dialogue, after successfully answering Vidagdha's query, Yajivarkya identifies all such Purusha as Atman, the all-present self, and overpowers it. It is equally important to note that the first section of this chapter, for the first time in entire Vedic corpus, Ajatasatru describes the Purusha in the human body as consisting of cognition, the knowing principle. Earlier, they were thinking, like Manas, Manju, all thinking principle. There was no distinction between thinking and knowing. So here, we see that some transformation is happening. So Purusha and Atman, these two principles are equated, and from that, Purusha now is distinguished from thinking even, and regarded as the knowing principle. Earlier, it was described only as consisting of mind, mano-mind. In the fourth section of this chapter, and in the third and fourth chapters, Yajivarkya recognizes this knowing principle as Atman, the self, as the greatest of all entities that have come into being. Please notice that now Atman has taken over the properties of Purusha. Beyond sight, beyond hearing, beyond speech is the thinking principle, and always it is, beyond it is the knowing principle. As he says, viewed from this greatest of all entities are all things existent in the world. Also immaterial entities such as entire corpus of human knowledge, starting with the Vedas, just like plumes of smoke from a fire. I find that philosophization on Atman reaches its height in Yajivalkya's discourses in the Vedaranyaka Upanishad. In earlier texts, even in some other parts of the Vedaranyaka Upanishad, Atman means something semi-physical and merely personal, related to the individual person. Vedic thinkers before Yajivalkya, who philosophized on the concept of person, Purusha, had seen the one and only person as the essence of everything mortal or immortal, inside or outside, and individual person as mere appearances of the universal person in different loki and conditions. Yajivalkya came up with the philosophized concept of Atman as the self, one, immortal and unchanging, and claim that physical, psychological or metaphysical persons seen or imagined at various levels of bodily and cosmic realms are none but this very self to which he is proposing, so his abstract notion of the self. Thus, he limited persons to the levels of appearance and accorded a uniquely exalted status only to the self. He also analyzed the self psychologically, and made a bold statement that the imperishable, all-pervasive and all-controlling self is none but one's own self. Okay, but let me conclude here so that we can have some question and answer.
Yes. Yes, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We may have time for two, three questions. Can we take those ones?
Yeah, yeah. That's why I now concluded, yeah, so that we can have enough time to discuss.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Please. raise hand if you, any of you have any questions.
Veena Raj. Yes, you can ask the question.
Oh, good morning, sir.
Yeah, please.
It is a pleasure listening to you on the concepts of Atman and Purusha. Right now, I am doing my PhD in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, in station of Shankara and the German scholar Bruckner, and also Max Müller's translation. So I was really interested in the topic. So my question, to be very precise, is after having surveyed the Vedic and the Upanishadic literature, do you have you reached the conclusion that in the Madhu Brahmana, as you cited, the concept of Atman and Purusha, they denote the same entity, or is Purusha something different from Atman? Because only Atma is related, is identified with Brahman, and not Purusha. It is not seen much. So can we conclude it?
Yeah, okay, let me elaborate. So first of all, even in certain context, Purusha can be used in the sense of Atman, but like even in Gita, Purusha can be Uttama, Purusha, Svanya, and so on. So Atma, Paramatma, they both can be interpreted as Purusha. But what I am telling is, before Madhu Brahmana, before Yajnavalkya's this abstraction, so in earlier phase, like in Sandilya's teaching, or even in when you have Upanishadic fervor, here they are talking about, and even in Gargiya Adata Satru's discourse, they talk about Atmani Purusha. So there is distinction between Atman. So the living body, living individual is Atman. And then Purusha is cosmic, universal, as well as individual essence. What Yajnavalkya does is actually very much systematically. At that point, he, and let me just read one passage. So he said that ayam atma sarvesham bhutanam madhu asya atmana sarvani bhutani madhu yasta asmin atmani tejomaya amritamaya purusha yasta atma tejomaya amritamaya purusha ayameva sa ayam atma idam amritam idam brahma idam sarvam. What he is doing here is, he first is pointing at the cosmic Purusha. So he starts with Purusha. He says that Purusha, amritamaya, tejomaya Purusha, that is on one side. And then on the other side, he points at, again, Purusha, that is Atmani. So the first he is using Atman in the sense of body. So this is Purusha in the human body or living body. And then he says, these both are none other than Atman. So actually, he is using Atman in two, or actually even three different senses. So one is, the final Atman, ayam Atma, is maybe within quotation marks, this abstract notion of Yajnavalkya's notion. Yajnavalkya's new revised notion of Atman is the last one. When it says Atmani Purusha in the beginning, then that is the body. And then when he is talking about the Atma, individual self. So the second and third, they can be, so just for the sake of practical notion, we can somehow distinguish. But what he is doing in this portion is, he is using Purusha frequently and equating cosmic as well as microcosmic, macrocosmic as well as microcosmic, and he is equating and pointing both Purushas and merging them into Atman, he is proposing. After that, so the, after that, this Madhu Brahmana, in the third and fourth, or even in other places, whenever Yajnavalkya talks, he doesn't use Purusha. As I said, even the Nabhidakta Sakalya, when he talks about Purusha, he is punished in a way. So after this, so the Purusha and Atman become synonym, but Purusha is not preferred. Certain other schools, like the Vaishnavas and others, they, and Sankhya, so they use Purusha frequently. But in Vedanta, after Yajnavalkya, you see that their preference is for Atman.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Any other?
Yes, any other? Joshi sir?
Yes. Thank you so much. Thanks.
So, shall I propose the vote of thanks now, sir? So, thank you, sir.
Yes, please.
If no other questions, yeah.
Yeah, it looks, shall we wait or shall we go ahead? I think there are no questions, perhaps.
Yes.
So, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Prasad Joshi, and today's guest of honor, Professor Diwakar G. Acharya, colleagues and friends, I on behalf of the Deccan College Bicentenary Lecture, very much sir, I hope all of us got benefited from your views on the notion of Purusha and Atmana. I take this opportunity to thank our Vice Chancellor Professor Prasad Joshi for organizing this event and for his brief comment. I thank Shilpa Suman ji and my organizing committee for their support to organize this event. We thank you all for being with us this evening in India and morning in London, sir. Thank you very much. Stay safe and stay healthy, sir.
Yeah, thank you also. Let me thank you, all of you. Thanks for listening. Thanks for organizing. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Diwakar ji,
thank you.
Yeah, let us meet again.
Yeah, thank you.
Interesting.